We'll start the meeting before we go on to minutes, which we can look at, have a few minutes to look at. I'd like to just open this to public comment. And Susan, would you like to introduce yourself?
I'll say hello. I'm Susan Roy. I live on Rivella Ave. I've lived there since 1973. I feel like the mayor of my street.
It's a great street.
Yeah, I live on Winthrop.
Well, you may know that there's some American hackberries in my yard and at the end of Winthrop and Harlow, so it's an interesting area from 100 years ago.
What house is yours?
59. It's near the end on the right. It's next to the Pryors.
What color is it? Is it a brick?
Brown.
Yeah, I think I've been in front. We've done some work in front of your house before. I bet you were never there if you weren't home, I don't think.
Well, I don't have trees in my front yard. It's the only sunny spot I have, so I have a huge garden. I have no grass.
Well, we did some work there. That's why there's no trees.
Yes. Yeah, when I bought my house, I had an American elm on one side and a three-bowl hackberry on the other side of the driveway, but they both had to come down for various reasons.
So would you like to describe your background and what brought you here today, and if you have any just general public comments for our meeting? This would be a great time.
I've always loved the city. When I first moved here, I was a UMass student in plant and soil science. I was the first woman in Massachusetts to become a certified arborist in 1976.
Wow, that is cool.
And, I worked for Cotton Tree in Frost and Higgins briefly.
Do you two know each other?
No.
You look familiar.
Because Jay worked for Cotton for a period of time.
I left in 81. I had a two-year-old daughter who, you know, the babysitter had her birthday party, and I went home to a bunch of lugs, and I thought, nah. So I went into floristry. I've been in horticulture all my life. I have a master's in entomology as well, and I'm always happy to key out bugs for people.
Oh, great. We were just talking about... Huh. No, I was talking to somebody else about how he wish he knew more about bugs and less about soil.
Bugs are fun. I never complain about looking at bugs and diseases. But, you know, I worked on the Conservation Commission for off and on for 10 years in the late 80s and the 90s, and kind of know every swamp in town. And I also worked on the mosquito control board for a while. So I've been busy in the town over a lot of years. And I just thought I'd like to come in and see if there's some little volunteer thing I can do. I'm not willing to go out and swamp around in the swamps anymore, which is why I told Wayne no more Conservation Commission.
So you worked on the CONSCOM for a period of time?
Yeah, I had a couple of periods of 4 or 5 years. I really don't have an agenda. I just think you're doing great work, and I'd like to come be supportive.
Thank you.
I'm a bit of a little old lady, but I can keep up. I'm just a shop. Whatever.
Okay, great. Well, thank you for that. All right, next is the approval of minutes from our last meeting.
Page, I think there's a misspell.
Mm-hmm. Portion?
Yeah. Instead of portion.
Potions.
But that would be kind of cool.
City's portion.
I
Do we have a motion to approve the minutes as corrected, portion to portion?
The one thing I want to say is on the to-do list recap, there were more items, so...
Yeah, I'm not too concerned about that. Minutes
okay.
really need to capture votes.
Yeah.
And you know, essential conversations,
mm-hmm.
and not to-do points, I think. That we have our Google spreadsheet for.
So should we just eliminate that from future notes?
You know, it's fine to have them there because it is another reminder,
mm-hmm.
like when someone right now is going through. So I don't mind to have them there, but I don't think that we need to worry if they're not.
Well, what I can do is I'll email Terry the list.
Okay.
So that when she does them,
that's a good
it'll
idea.
Be complete.
Yeah.
Even though we don't have to worry about them.
Okay.
Okay.
She has access to them.
To the Google spreadsheet.
Yes.
Yeah. Also, we made some changes to it. Instead of having them all listed on one sheet, we now have a tab for each commissioner. Because we thought that would be easier.
Oh, that's interesting. I know what this is.
Yeah. Just probably not to,
yeah,
today.
This morning.
Yeah.
Okay. Am I getting to buy you a tab?
Yeah.
You get two tabs.
The first tab.
Double tab?
Yeah, you get two tabs.
All right. So do we have a motion to approve the minutes as they stand? Or as they stand corrected?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstain? Okay, two abstentions. All right. Chair report. This will be brief. Yes, I have this on my item. Does anyone want an actual copy of these things, or are these your copies?
Pass them around if anyone wants.
Okay. So, continuing with our conversation with the city about incorporating trees more proactively into planning, there's one follow-up workshop, public forum to the one that happened in April, and that is on Wednesday, May 18th. That one I actually am going to be able to go to. So it's in your minutes. I'm sorry, it's on your agenda. But I'm happy to pass this on if anyone wants to take a look at it. And then the other one, which is any Tuesday is bad for me, so it's really too bad. Because this is the one I really would love to go to, is the one on Main Street Design Workshop. Is this also Alta? I think
yes,
it is also Alta. So a lot of the things that we communicated when we met with the Alta guy, I feel like, you know, we had an opportunity to say a few things, but we'll go into greater detail. So that's here, and this is on the agenda as well.
That's next Tuesday.
It's the 10th. That's next Tuesday. Can I have a show of hands of people who think they might be at the one on the 10th? Let's say that's the Main Street one.
What time is it?
6 p.m.
So we have Jen and Tom.
I think I can. I got to double check. I'm pretty sure I could.
Okay, so two people. Well, represent us, you know.
Hardcore,
yeah. And then what about the next walk bike one on the 18th? Show of hands. That's on a Wednesday, 6:30 p.m.
Yeah.
I'm going to be able to go to that. Okay, good. So we at least have two people at each. That's kind of it for. That's kind of it for the chair report. One thing I did want to ask is that we have a good amount of time, 20 minutes. In our other business section. And I just want to see if there's anything people would like to talk about that isn't on today's agenda. I'm not getting a lot of proactive input from you guys on agendas. You know, it's on our Google Calendar, so you should get a notice every Wednesday before our meeting that if you want to give me input, give me input. But I haven't been getting input. So that's not a chiding thing, it's just a, you know, we like things to be on the agenda in order for the public to be able to anticipate them. If you have anything that you want on this agenda, we have 20 minutes in other business, and I'm happy to add those if anybody has anything. Like, for example, Todd, do you want to talk at all about ordinance stuff?
Or
I'm not really, yeah, we can put that on a future agenda. I noticed in the minutes, we were supposed to be talking about the 25 grand left in the budget, and I'm supposed to be on the, in fact, in, under your report, or should we add that?
No, that should be under my report.
Okay. So let's count on us talking about ordinances in the next meeting.
Great.
What about just the spring tree planting, like what we had left?
Okay, we can talk about that today, under other business.
Yeah, just like what's going on, what needs to happen.
Okay.
Lily, just following up on some of your to-dos from the last meeting, did you have anything that you want to report on the door hangers or the...
I haven't gotten to that, actually. I haven't gotten to door hangers. One thing I can report on is that I sent an email to Wayne. Yes, those door hangers have arrived, but she's talking about, remember, we were going to do different variations of the door.
Oh, for like what kind of mulch and...
And new setbacks.
So I've come across a volunteer who's working on possibly labeling trees, possibly door hangers, just little signs when we plant trees. Just, she hasn't done anything, but she's interested in helping with signage and wordage. And someone who's a communicator and writer as opposed to a person with a shovel. And so we'll see where that goes. She is working briefly on that.
This is what
GJ has been supplying about labels.
You know what that reminds me of? I do want to put under other business just to discuss a little bit as volunteers come in, what's our protocol like? Do we want to start having a volunteer intake form, something like that? We don't currently have anything like that, so maybe we can discuss that. Okay, that's it for my chair report. Thank you, Patty.
Okay, so my giant list that I had last week that I was given so graciously by all the commission members, other than, of course, Todd wasn't here.
I had another list for you.
Yeah, you have another list. Totally separate. So things for the, obviously for Arbor Day were all completed. Those were done. I owe Principal Kanata an email, which I have not done yet, but I will get to that. We're hopefully going to plant the trees tomorrow. By the way, the bare root trees, I think, will be gone by the end of this week.
Tomorrow morning
will be
excellent.
It. Yeah.
That's it.
So that's pretty, that's basically 10, 14 day turnaround because they came two Thursdays ago.
Mm-hmm.
Considering all the moving parts, you know.
No, it's good because they were buried completely. And yeah. And so the ones that we planted today looked like they weren't leafing out.
So it was 14 days turnaround. It all worked well, Jay. Directed us to the brilliant idea of burying the whole thing, but it only worked, I think, Dave, because they had they really hadn't leafed out at all.
Couldn't do it once they start to leaf out.
Right. So we cannot say, okay, we can always just bury them and then plant them 2 weeks later.
No, it's been a strange spring though because it was very warm very quickly, and now it's actually gotten kind of damp and cold.
Yeah.
So that actually worked in our favor, actually slowing down.
So it all works in our favor, but it's not necessarily a system, that's all.
So, are you all set, Rob?
Yeah, that was all. That's the point I added.
So I did receive the contract from DCR for the...
Rich, can I just ask you a couple of things about Arbor Day first?
Sure.
Just to wrap that up.
We are going to have an Arbor Day conversation.
Mm-hmm. I was just wondering, did all the tree whips get distributed? Or were there some left over?
No, we have probably... Maybe 20
left over. Mm-hmm.
We're going to plant them at the cemetery like we did last year.
Okay.
We're trying to propagate a small impromptu nursery, I guess you would say. We're also using some of the plant material for screening material. So eventually, we have elms that were there that we planted many years ago that are now, Liberty elms actually, they were replacement elms that they gave us. They're there, plus some other tree stock that was there. And we've created a buffer zone to screen from the actual where the grave spaces are in the cemetery to where the actual maintenance buildings are. So eventually they're a mix of conifers and hardwoods. So we can have the ability to take some of those out of there eventually to move them around as street trees, but I like to leave some of them in there to continue that screen because that was part of our marching orders from the planning department when we built the maintenance building in the cemetery. So it kind of serves two purposes.
Yeah, thanks.
That's it? Okay, long answer, but yes. We have some left over, yeah. Received the contract from DCR from Julie Coop with the letter of, with our letter actually stating that congratulations. We are going to, this letter came from Leo Roy, the commissioner. Says, dear Mr. Parsley, on behalf of Governor Charles Baker and Energy and Environmental Secretary's Affairs, Matthew Beaton, I am pleased to announce that the Department of Conservation and Recreation has selected your project entitled Northampton's First Professional Public Shade Tree Inventory for Massachusetts, DCR Urban and Forestry Challenge Grant. Your project has been approved in amount of $30,000. We were, they received 12 applications totaling $191,354 for grant requests. Using funds from the USDA Forest Service and the Mass Relief Trust Fund, the DCR is able to award grant funds to 8 of the applicants in this round of grants, so we're very lucky.
Getting almost a third of the...
Yeah. So that's our award letter, and then they sent me a whole contractor, which I am working with Joe Cook, to basically, it's going to be treated as a vendor cover sheet. It's like a regular standard contract. It goes in front of the mayor signs it, and then I send it all back to DCR. The only issue with this is that this contract ends June 30th this year. Standard, I believe, because it's the end of the fiscal year, we'll have to do a contract extension to get us through to the fall so we can be completely finished.
Mm-hmm. And so, remember, yes, not Julie, but the name escapes me now, it's tip of my tongue, but Melissa.
Molly.
Molly said that they would work with us because of the compressed timeline.
Yes, I think what they're going to make us do is they're going to make us do a whole new vendor cover sheet all over again because it's the end of this year. It's standard operating procedure.
Okay.
I called her today and asked her if she's pretty confident. So we emailed Julie and we're waiting for Julie to answer that. So that part of it is in process. The other part that I've worked on that is not complete, but I have done probably about 3/4 of it is the RFP. So I have a hard copy here that I don't necessarily think I want to share with you at this moment. I want to actually email it to all of you so you can review it and then comment on it because it really won't be ready to go until this whole contract piece is completed. But basically, I put it in our regular bid form that we have, which is standard procurement bid, and we just have to send it. You know, one of the things I did write in here, though, is that the firm or individual contract to develop this inventory shall be an ISA certified arborist with a minimum of 5 years experience. Certified arborist shall have a clear experience of completing 5 comprehensive public shade tree inventories in southern New England or western Massachusetts. Each inventory shall have had a minimum of 1,000 trees surveyed. The certified arborist shall provide a list of no less than 5 references from communities where similar inventories were completed. Certified arborist shall have a working knowledge of GIS and GPS systems, and then it will go on to basically take the information that we actually compiled in our grant application, plus some other things that came from a couple other RFPs, one from Amherst and one from Michigan.
Hi, Virginia. Feel free to pull up the seat if
you want. You say we're not allowed to contact the contractors and find out if they have, which ones have to meet their requirements ahead of time?
No, I'm sorry. It's got to be blind. You can ask them, but there's no point. We're going to require them. We're going
right.
to make them produce.
Well, I'm just wondering if the people we're thinking of actually would meet that requirement. They would.
That's what I was wondering if we could expand it beyond Southern New England, you know?
We do have 20 minutes on the agenda to discuss this.
Okay.
So I'd like for us to postpone this discussion because I actually do want to dig a little bit into it while we are in an open session.
Okay, fair enough.
Just to finish that thought, the only thing that I have experience is that not everybody has experience working in this region based on the limited availability of funds for this type of work. So it might be worth considering like mid-Atlantic states up to Maine because there's so much work that takes place in Pennsylvania that it might be unfortunate if we cut off.
New York?
Yeah, I would say, yeah.
Pennsylvania, New York, or
yeah.
Giant.
Yeah.
Nearby.
Okay. The monies for the city's portion of this inventory has been put from the city council. They voted one reading, so we're one reading away from paying the rest of the money in our own account, which is good.
Mm-hmm.
623 Kennedy Road, which we had a public shade hearing back in March. The residents there are proceeding with the work as planned. They have provided me with all the pertinent information that I feel comfortable that they have done enough work for mitigation to replace the public shade trees they're going to be removing with their own plantings and kind design services and their installation of a plant material. And the other request we had was a public shade tree hearing at 28 Gleason Road, but turns out that how that tree is private. So I worked with the, I actually took the time and sent an iTree benefit value to them. Basically say, look, this is what this tree has done, this is what it's presently doing, and this is what it's going to do about 30, 40 years out. So, you know, I don't have any jurisdiction over your property, however said, you know, please consider this, the benefit value this tree has, and consider planting trees, other trees on your property, which they agreed to do. So I'm going to work with them to try to find proper species to plant in their side of their house, which won't impact their solar panels. So I think every time someone actually reaches out to me like that, and it's not under my jurisdiction, I am going to actually send them out.
Great, no, I saw, you CC'd me on the letter, I thought it was great.
So, and that's kind of quick, I don't really have, I've just been kind of, we have a new director.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So we have a new director, so I asked her to come to a meeting, she will come to a meeting in the future. She's kind of busy this first couple of days here, so.
Come to a tree commission meeting?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, yeah, she is, got a lot of experience actually on the utility side of things, because she worked for Green Mountain Power in Vermont, Southern Vermont. So she's very familiar with utility work in regards to public right-of-way with trees. So definitely looking forward to developing a good relationship with her. And I have not really picked her brain yet about trees, but so we'll see. So I really haven't a chance to really sit and meet with her. She's really been taking up this week's time, because Jim Morrow, the city engineer, is leaving on Friday, it's his last day, so there's been a lot of compressed time that she needs to sit with him to kind of get a handle on all the projects that we have and that going on, that wasn't during the pipe, so. There's a lot going on at DPW, all I can tell you is that I take a lot of handle. I think Debbie can attest to that.
It's tougher than it gets.
Yeah, I've never been this thing.
Keep it light, keep it light.
Oh, well.
Oh, dear Rich, well, at least you guys have a captain at the helm soon. I mean, that's going to be, that's going to only be better.
Yeah, it will be better, because then we have someone to help us, you know, muddle through all these difficult decisions. Our department is so diversified, it's, you know, it's very, to find someone to fill that position is really hard, because they have to have such a diverse background and have to have so much experience that it's really, a really hard job. Anyways, that is about it for me, and I have other things to talk about with, you know, the tree inventory issues.
Yeah, yeah.
Arbor Day, so.
Okay, good.
Add my two cents.
Yep, they're all on the agenda. Okay, so the next topic is Arbor Day. I'd love for us to just to do a debrief of what worked, what could be improved. I'll just say from my perspective, I thought it was a hugely successful day. We had the weather completely on our side. We had the most darling school kids imaginable, really eager to plant trees. You know, it all went really, really well from my perspective. I'd love to hear how it went from Rich and the crew's perspective, and of course, Marilyn, you being the organizer, so I'm going to turn it over to you.
Well, first of all, thanks for all you do, Rich.
Well, I'm not, it's just, you know, we have a lot of support, you know. It's myself, I have Tony, Angel, Jimmy, and Alan, and then I have Terry, and then I have Debbie as well. And everyone here and on the operational side is a very integral part. I couldn't really do, I'm actually just a front person, that's how I look at myself. I'm the actual person that directs everyone that's behind me, and the people that are behind me actually want to do the work, and they really deserve a lot of credit, because, you know, some days I don't get out of my office, other days I'm all over the place, but they're really the ones that make it happen. And then the flip side of that is that the people that are sitting at this table, so you're an amazing group of people. We would not have been able to pull this off if it wasn't for the hard work and dedication of all of you. Because this was something that was not comprehensible to me 15 years ago when I really wanted to plant trees on Arbor Day. I think the first tree I ever planted on Arbor Day was with Jay. And we planted the tree in Pulaski Park. And it was like a big deal. It was one tree. Jay and I were there. I don't know if you worked for Smith at the time, but anyways.
Is it still there?
No, it had to get removed because of the changes of grade in the park. But I mean, it's been, giving away tree rips is awesome, but actually going to the schools and planting trees with kids and then...
In the downtown.
Yeah, and then the following day, which was really great for me personally, was I volunteered. I just kind of found Robin, went with Robin, planted trees with volunteers instead of doing the tree rip giveaway, which was really good for me because I got to meet some other volunteers that I wouldn't normally meet, made some nice connections, and it just is very satisfying to see what we did. It's amazing when you put a good group of people together, what you're going to get accomplished. I'm really just very, it's really changed my whole outlook, I think. I like the highway superintendent part of my job, but I like this part a lot better.
Great!
Anyways.
Well, especially because we have visitors, just to give a recap, we did distribute 400 tree whips with, as Rich said earlier, just about 20 left over, which will go in the cemetery. We did that on Friday from 9 till 3, and then again Saturday from 9 till noon. And we had 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13 volunteers helping with tree whip distribution. And we had sent out a public survey last fall to Northampton citizens, and one of the many questions was, would you be willing to help with Arbor Day? So these people were generated through that survey answer. And two of the people from that survey also volunteered at the tree plantings. We did three of the elementary schools in town, Bryan Road, Bridge Street, and Jackson Street. The Leeds Elementary School planting will happen this week without the children. We couldn't quite get in there this year, but perhaps next year. But as Lily mentioned, the tree planting at the schools was, it was a bright, sunny day, and we did two third grade classes at Ryan Road. Jay led that at 9:30 in the morning, and it was right on a little island in front of the school's entrance, two maples, and the kids were real enthusiastic about that. And then we did Bridge Street at noon, an Elm Street and a little leaf linden. And it's right on, is it Lampon?
Lampard Park.
When I drive by there every day to and from work, I just feel so proud because there they stand. It was a first grade class and a kindergarten class that did that. And the mayor showed up for that one.
Yeah.
And then Jen and Lily led that. Mm-hmm. And then Lily and I led the one at Jackson Street, and it's right along the Jackson Road, right inside the fence, and we helped explain to the kids that this will help with traffic calming and noise pollution, and that was a fourth grade class and first grade class, and the kids were just so enthusiastic, and those were two little leaf lindens. I have followed up with all the teachers, and they were just really so thankful that we initiated this and included that this year. Angie, a volunteer and friend of Lily's, did some photography. She sent me the photos today, but they're in a zipped file and I couldn't open them. But as soon as I get those, I'll add them to the rest. Because we got photos from the three schools and some in front of City Hall on Saturday for the whip distribution. So we have a nice collection, and even some in front of the Cedar Chest. That was part of the Arbor Day events. Again, going up and down Main Street, when I look over there, it's a sizable tree. Yeah, right in the corner of Thorns. Lily sent out a press and photo release. I don't get the Gazette. Did anybody see any press on this?
No. Was something I was gonna mention.
They'd given it to us beforehand. They gave us some press beforehand because people contacted me.
Mm-hmm. But it was in Mass Live or Only in Northampton. What's the name of that? Only in Northampton?
Uh-huh.
Is that the name of it? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Because we did, there was a little blurb and then it had pictures of several of us.
Oh, cool.
Yeah.
And thanks to Jay and Jen and Rob for providing information that, there's a lot of information out there, but we compiled a handful of things for the teachers to go over with their students beforehand. So how to plant bare root trees and why plant bare root trees, 22 reasons to plant and care for trees or defend a tree standing and how to care for trees. Anyway, it was, next year, as Lily suggested, we perhaps could compile things that are a little bit more children friendly.
Although the at least one class, the fourth grade class I worked with, the teachers had definitely incorporated into their curriculum that week, because when we did the sit down and I did the, let's see if we can come up with 10 benefits of trees, the kids.
Oh yeah, they were rattling.
They were there.
And also, we handed out to each class and each school for their library one of those fan decks. Has anybody seen those? They're really fun. They're colorful.
Tree ID.
Yeah, there's a tree, you know, so each one is has the shape of the tree and the leaf and information on it. So they were psyched for that. And trees are good tattoos. And anyway, it wasn't too much stuff, but things that hopefully will be useful and make the kids excited. So again, the last thing I have to do on this is compile all the photos, but I think we got some good ones. And
yeah, I bet Angie's are great. She has a really good camera and she's a good photographer.
Yeah.
I have a few on my camera from the mayor planting on on a Main Street.
Mm-hmm. I don't know, any questions or?
Well, I'd love for us to maybe feedback. Just talk about what things worked and what didn't. Like, I have a few tangible things that I'd love to see change for next year.
Yeah.
One is the speed of water for the kids at the plantings. You know, it took forever for water to come out of those enormous jugs. You know what I'm talking about, the barrels?
Yeah.
If there could just be a better system for water, maybe after the first planting, you guys need to go and fill the water back up so that there's full pressure on the barrels so the water comes out faster.
I think what we're going to do next year is we have a 250-gallon tank that's available that slides in the back of a one-ton.
Okay.
I think we're going to use that as a small 8-horsepower engine on it, and it'll just fill the.
That's for the baskets, right? You just use that truck.
They have. That one, we have our own, which is a different one. You can, same thing, use theirs as well.
Oh, it has a pump on it?
It has a pump on it.
Oh.
So it's not gravity.
Yeah.
Okay, that's great. I mean, the yogurt containers were brilliant.
That made
things so fun for the kids. They got really sloppy and happy.
Yeah.
What were the yogurt containers?
What they scooped the soil and water with. Worked really well. The other thing that I would just say is, Rich, how did the Douglas firs go with the whip selections?
They actually, they're almost, there's only about six of them left. You know what's left? Mainly sugar maples.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. Can I make a comment on that? I thought a lot of the sugar maples and the redbuds were pretty poor.
Yep.
Yeah, it was kind of discouraging people with their selections on the sugar maples. I was like, don't take that one, that one's dead.
The redbuds actually, when they came, and I owe Dave Hawkins an email from Mass Tree Wards and Forest Association, because that's where I buy them through him. I think the red buds were already dried out, severely dried out.
By the time we even got them. Yeah.
They actually didn't look like they really had many buds on them at all. Of course, I know they're a later tree in the season, but they were like the worst looking that I've ever seen out of getting any red bud batch. And I also think that, just what we're talking about, this maybe next year we should offer maybe a wider variety and just keep it a smaller, you know, maybe keep it 400, but offer, or maybe go 500 and offer a different variety just to add a little more. Because people are always asking, well, do you have this, do you have that? And of course, lilacs, they disappear immediately because people want, you know, they want multiples.
Mm-hmm. They were also budding out really clearly.
They were, and they were pretty healthy.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Maybe we could just keep like a tapper. Obviously, it's easy to come up with ideas, but maybe part of the volunteer process next year could be just keeping track of what people are asking for, just as a way of helping to inform our next decision.
Good idea.
Do we have any of the red buds at hand still?
No,
they're gone.
Is there any money back if they arrive deceased, or is it just kind of?
It's a good question. I don't believe there's anything on there. I could probably talk to him.
So
2 years ago, the tulip trees came and they looked deadish. I took home 20 or so and planted them, got six trees, two of which were good. So maybe we should just take three of each deadish looking one and plant them ourselves. Otherwise, we never know what happened.
Sure.
So
I did take one red bud.
Oh, you did?
Try it.
And yeah, I did too.
What's happening?
Oh, good.
Nothing yet.
Well, I think knowing that nothing happened, or if they turn into
took it out of the bag, there was a one little teeny root on it. It didn't look very promising.
Dan, you have one too?
Yeah.
Would one of you like email us all if you get a tree?
Oh, if you get, yeah, it's in my garden, I just bought it.
Yeah, if you get a tree, because then we'll know that, hey.
There was a lot. It looked a little,
And I ran into Rob, someone who said, you know, I picked up a tulip tree from the city last year, and it's like this tall now.
Wow.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's.
Yeah, I have one actually of those, and it's actually 6 feet tall.
Yeah,
and
2 years ago.
And I'm actually going to put it in someone's yard tomorrow.
That's awesome. Great,
Two suggestions.
Yeah. I have one available, too.
Sorry, Rob?
I also have one available.
Mm-hmm. Red bud?
For
a tulip tree.
If somebody wants one for the yard.
So, I'm fine with the fact that lilacs are popular and they go. In fact, if we know that, then maybe we should always get like 200 lilacs and then 300 of a variety of other trees. Just give the people what they want. You know, I think any planting is good. You know, a lilac is a great, it's a great job.
I think it'll bring more people. You know, a lot of people, I think on Saturday, and I wasn't there for long, but you know, lilacs, like,
yesterday,
it was interesting. On Saturday, we actually had some people, because all that was left at that point were the sugar maples and the firs, and people are like, oh no, they're going to get too tall and too shady. And we were saying, well, that's what we're trying to do.
Well, that brings a really good point, Marilyn, is that, you know, in my kind of place, setback plantings, the dogwood, the redbud, they're like the enemy, because you'll have a big yard and someone will put a little dogwood or a little red but in it, and that's the end. Mm-hmm. You know, then there's no shade tree. So I actually saw that list, was a little disappointed, because shade trees that are likely to get planted, which doesn't necessarily include sugar maples.
You know, people have backyards too.
If you would like some American hackberries, I have so many seedlings in my yard, I could easily potch a 30 or 50.
People have backyards, but they might. I'm just saying, I go around trying to do setback plantings, and every time there's a dogwood or a redwood, then there's no setback planting.
Right, right.
So I don't know if I want to encourage them.
Two suggestions I have for next year is, if possible, to have, if we can maybe get to the schools a little earlier to do the posters, because that was so nice last year to catch people's attention walking by. Because when we were out in front of City Hall on Saturday, you know, we were kind of calling out to people.
Oh, the posters for the art thing.
Yeah, I think something a little bit more visual. Because, you know, people, when they see solicitors, kind of, you know, avert their eyes. But if they see something.
Downtown, really?
If they see something that looks a little bit more inviting, like, you know, a child's poster of a tree.
Halfway through the event on Friday, someone thought of putting the little trees up on the table.
Yeah. And the other thing is, maybe next year at the schools, we could take the children to the trees that we planted this year. Like, oh, let's see how the trees are doing from 2016. And then go out and plant new trees, just as a.
Well, another thing is, you know, I had talked kind of informally when I did the tree planting with the fourth grade at Jackson Street about them adopting the tree and watering it, at least until school's out, and then watering it again in the fall. But we didn't wrap that into the expectation for class, and I'm wondering if we can at least pose that as a possibility. You know, as much as we can free up our DPW crew from doing watering and have them be spending their time doing other things, I'd love to do that. One other thing about the schools that I'd just like to do is, I'd like to start a lot earlier with identifying planting sites, and if there are concerns or questions about the sites we choose, I'd like to learn that early on, so we can either have an opportunity to educate them about why, in fact, that is a great site, or work with them to find a site that's mutually desirable. I felt like with Leeds, we got a curveball at the last minute. Now we know that about Leeds. And then also with Jackson Street, we kind of got the same thing where they, at the last minute, we heard that the groundspeople didn't like the location for the trees that we, or the sites that we had chosen for the trees. And so we had to go with a really, really much less desirable location that is going to be fine for traffic calming, but it's not going to add to the quality of life for the children at the school at all. So I don't know, Rich, maybe this is something like we have a sit down with the principals and really, or with the groundspeople and have an opportunity to educate them about all of the benefits we're trying to provide in our tree plantings. I don't know, we can brainstorm about that, but I'd really like to get in front of that.
So is there, you're pretty much assuming you're gonna do it again next year at the schools? Is that the,
I mean, I would think so. There's an abundant,
it's good.
Abundant
we, yes.
places. There's places. That's what I'm
yeah.
wondering.
The only place that really has limitations is, Bridge Street School really has no property to plant on, so we're actually planting on City Park property. Mm-hmm. So there's, Lily and I walked over this probably
four
easily
more.
Four to six other locations we can plant, you know, sizable trees that will impact kids plus people that are walking on the sidewalk.
Yeah.
Leeds School, the only problem with Leeds School is that it's a little limited and there's tree plantings actually farther away from the school if you're driving on Florence Street on the hill. Mm-hmm. And then there's plantings area in front of the school, the old section of the school, but there was a little bit of a struggle there with a push pull with the principal not wanting the debris to be blown into the school because apparently they leave the doors open all day long. So. I just don't understand it.
You can't leave
it.
Debris.
Yeah, that's because you do not leave the doors open all day long.
Do we mean leaves? So, is that what leaves?
No, it's actually about leaving the doors open and having leaves
yes,
actually get into
leaves
the school.
Slowly.
Because there were multiple sugar maples at one time in front of the old mm-hmm. the school many years ago when I first came here, big ones. And they died and they just cut them down and never replaced them. So, you know, the thing is that they're at the schools, you know, the principals really have control over the building and the grounds no matter what. But because that's how the legislature, you know, the MGL laws are written in regards to the Education Reform Act. But the groundspeople get involved because they have to maintain it. The principal's on it, they're raking the leaves, the principal's on it, they're cutting the branches off the trees. So it's kind of this, like this push and pull. The thing that happened in Jackson Street, I'm still trying to decipher, you know, exactly what's wrong. They were afraid the trees are going to be so big that the students would get lost and they would take the wrong bus. You know, so anyways, it was just, so I think, good point.
I'd love to just get in front of it.
Communication.
Yeah.
Also, the other thing I thought about is actually reaching out. We don't necessarily just have to reach out to the public schools. There's two other schools mm-hmm. in town. There's the Campus Hill School, and there is the
Montessori.
The Montessori School, and the Landers?
Yep.
Schechter. Linda Branson. Yep. On Prospects. So there's other places where we can do.
There's also Sunnyside. I'm with the grounds committee.
Yeah, Sunnyside. Yeah.
So there's other places where we could have an impact that would not, you know, that would be a little more far reaching than what we've done.
Uh-huh.
Would you have to stay within 20 feet of right away?
I'm sure we could probably figure out. Yeah, we could.
Our way of going. Or some way of doing it.
Yes. Yeah. I think the other thing too is that if we're going to do it next year, I think planting two trees at each school was good this year, but I think without having leads to do operationally, it was actually easier because we only have so much time during the day,
yeah.
especially for the support services to get this set up out here,
right.
plus to get, you know, everything delivered, especially if we're going to go the bare root method, because we had to dig up the bare root stock that morning mm-hmm. and make sure that it didn't dry out because the day was, you know, warm, the sun came out. So operationally speaking, it might be better off to do one tree per school and actually concentrate on, because I thought what you did at Jackson Street was, you know, they sat all the students down and they
yeah.
actually had about 15 minutes of time with the students and then they went and planted the two trees. We were able to actually get the trees planted because the tree crew and myself, we actually formed the holes to the tree, which made it really easy.
Yeah.
Instead of what we did
right.
over at Bridge Street,
right,
which
right,
is
right.
that you worked with the students.
Right.
They were younger, they were a much younger group,
right.
so more focused on the worms and the rocks,
right.
I think, than the actual trees. But mm-hmm. I think a lot of them were, they enjoy themselves, so I think if, I think one tree per school would be probably easier for all of us, I think. And then it will also extend the life of being able to plant more trees at the schools for a longer period of time.
Okay, all right, all good ideas.
It's on the one in front of Thorns, just that was pretty good. I don't know if any of you saw it, but there was a sculpture by Robert Markey that got installed for most of the month. It was tied into Arts Night Out, and the Northampton Center for the Arts helped with that. Thorns put up some money for the sculpture, and then also all the money for the tree and the work. So I'm now working to find a second home for the sculpture, and then possibly expand the number of artists that show. So there were some other interested artists, sculptures interested in that as well. Plenty of sites, I think, downtown, and certainly if we expand it. So looking at Pinch, since that tree was just taken down, and then there's one other on that side of the street, and then there's a couple mostly dead trees that I think we can work with as well. So looking forward to expanding that as well.
There's the mayor.
Good.
I can pass this around. See the mayor planting the tree.
Was that before or after you even told me off his phone?
Did I say that?
Yes, ma'am.
No, it was so not me.
You said, David, are you going to help plant that tree? And he's doing this.
Oh, yeah, he's a little
addicted. Hold on a second, I'm just going to send this text.
That's right. Not memory service.
And I'm over there and I'm like,
probably tweeting.
Saying that, and I'm not saying that.
speaking of things going around, there's a card from the Huntley family thanking us for sending them a card about planting a tree for them. So I'm going to put that on other business because I do want us to not forget to plant a tree in memory of Ned.
Yeah. Speaking of that, actually, just quickly, I'm going to talk to Ed Etheridge from Oak Park. They have a really good, and I think you have one as well, but they also have a very good policy for planting and dedicating trees to individuals. So I'd like to review that and review Smith's policy and see if we can actually come up and use the language to craft our own.
Great.
Just a quick question about downtown trees.
Yes.
The overhead power line, is that just for the...
That's just for the streetlights, so National Grid does not...
Okay, that's just for like the...
Yeah, if that was the case, every tree in the city would be topped.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
Great.
Yeah, hopefully, something we did discuss with Phil is hopefully all those utilities be buried.
Can you put that on your when you do the Main Street talk? Can you put that as a request, or is that already on your radar?
Sure.
Okay, great.
Not to get too far off topic, but buried utilities. Make sure that there's a good schematic for how deep they are, because I'm running into this problem right now. We're replacing some trees where all the utilities have been buried, and nobody knows. Like if it's encased in conduit, it's encased in concrete. It's 4 feet down, 6 feet down. So it limits your options unless you know exactly what you're dealing with when you bury it. So that's part of the long-term consideration.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. We're finally starting to do that at Smith. We're GPSing all the utilities as we put them in now.
Mm. Cool. That's good.
But it's fairly recent.
Yeah.
Okay.
Utilities long before GPS.
I think the other thing, just to talk about quickly, I think that the bare root method really was unique, and it was really a great experience for me. I've never done bare root planting. Thanks to Jay, I've got a ton of education. And thanks to Rob, I worked with Rob as well. But I think if we're going to do that type of thing, if they're successful and they make it through the summer and they overwinter well, I really would consider doing that again. I think it's really comparison to actually trying to huff that giant ball into the hole in front of Thorns. Mm-hmm. It was like a cakewalk, And that
we think we need to look maybe at other nurseries or better delivery method, because we could have some issues.
Yeah, there were issues with the roots being broken and just the way they were handled. Not thinking there was enough hydrogel.
Yeah, some of them were they couldn't have been left any longer.
And also, it seems like they grow them, at some point maybe dig them and then regrow them, because there were a lot of them that had these big structural roots that had been cut off maybe long ago. Mm-hmm. Can you see the formation of them? to, there were a lot of...
They probably cut, yeah, I was noticing that too. Some of the cuts look old enough that I recut all the big roots.
Yeah, so there was, they had histories that we don't understand that, and...
You think they were root pruning them at some point?
Something like that.
They probably got them from a nursery and then planted them and put them back and just let them grow, you know?
Yeah, something like that. So I think finding other nurseries, are, do we know, that we can get them from? That do this?
Yes, I would imagine there must be.
There, I also think it's worthwhile giving them feedback and finding out what their reply is to your complaints. Also, seeing if the trees, how the trees do, because that really is the proof. All right, so I want to move us along so we can stay on our timeline here. The next agenda topic is the tree inventory, and I hear, Rich, that you say your thing isn't quite ready for prime time.
No,
I'm
getting there. Another couple hours of work.
Okay, so what what I would like to do is try to understand what our timeline is for this, so that we're making sure that we're marching along in time enough to give a vendor enough time to complete this project, because we said we want to have this project done by November. So my hope last week was that we kind of take that deadline and work backwards and find out how long it would likely take someone to complete this project, so that we give them enough time to respond to an get the RFP and respond to it, and then have enough time to execute it. Because it seems like a big freaking project.
It is a big project, but the nice thing is, because this is horizontal design specs, the rules are a little different than if it was a Chapter 31B, which is like a building or road construction. So it's very, like I said, if we didn't put the word bid in the document, we could have actually just sent out, asked for three quotes. So we actually only have to put this in the central register. We have to go in Goods and Services. So Goods and Services is like almost a month, has to sit there for like 3 weeks, basically. So we actually, once this is put together, I can actually put this, because the money is available to us. We have the money from the city council now in the mayor's office, and we have the grant money. I can put this out possibly by next week. And actually my timeline on here, Tuesday, May 24th was the bid opening.
Okay, well, we're not gonna, well, we have one, yeah, we will have one more meeting before then. So
I think to expedite things, I may send it to you all electronically and then ask for your comments back to me individually. And then I can adjust the RFP, and then once that happens, then it needs to go to Joe Cook, so Joe Cook can review it. But I've been working with him on this.
Right.
And then the other issue is just working with the state, you know, and getting this contract signed. So once the mayor signs the vendor cover sheet, the state can take as long as they want, as long as it doesn't matter. As long as the mayor signs the vendor cover sheet, that's the end of it. That means the contract's valid. He sends it them for a copy, and that's very easy. And then we'll have to just do our contract over again with them, probably sometime in June. But
sorry if I missed this, Rich. Yes. At the last meeting, you mentioned getting bid specifications from Wally, and...
I did. I ended up getting...
You did?
I got bid specs from Alan Snow and from the planning department, the city of Chicopee.
Okay.
Yeah, they just did one?
Yeah. And theirs is an RFP, though, so theirs is a lot more complicated, because they are actually looking for a qualified certified, or a certified arborist that is going to actually... they're outside certified. It's very different than what we're doing. We're asking for an inventory from a firm that has certified arborists on board. So,
and they were asking for a certified arborist to go look at each tree. Is that what you're
They were actually
something like that. Be physically on the job.
Well, first of all, it's an RFP, which is different. So an RFP has to go out in a different form. Professional certified arborist services. So this document is much longer. It's one.
And do we know if it's possible to get an extension?
It is going to be possible. Yeah. There's no issue with that.
But we're still our goal is to get this thing done by the end of fall, right?
Yes. And that I would imagine.
Yeah, but just the time period really depends on the contractor and how many people they put on the job. I mean, you can do it in a very short time with a lot of people, or you can take all summer with fewer people.
Yeah.
But really depends on how they.
You can also set bid, you can also say this contract will, you know, be from this date to this date. And then you, contractor has 3 months to complete the work, that's it. Yes, sir.
Do we have the ability to choose a contractor based on things other than price?
Yes and no.
That's why they do the RFP, so they can make the decision on something completely unrelated to price.
Yeah. Yes and no, we have the right to reject all bids, so that's typically what we end up doing with this type of bid document if something comes back. But I really don't think you're gonna see like a mom and pop tree service bid on this thing, you know, I think we're gonna end up with Davy.
Who's that?
Yeah, so I mean, I would.
Davy or one other, or none?
Well, there's one that keeps poking us about.
Arbor Pro?
Yeah.
Yeah, they're a national, Arbor Pro, are they, they're a national, cause they're from California.
Yeah, they see their trucks on tech.
Yeah.
Does Save a Tree do it?
Don't believe I've ever seen one from them, no.
But I guess what Andrew was touching on is that if you write up the requirements in terms of how many trees they, how many Southern New England projects they've been on and whatnot, to preclude the people you, you really be careful not to preclude the people you actually wanna have make the bids. Like that company you just mentioned, maybe doesn't operate in New England much, maybe just in New York.
As long as they can actually prove to me that they've actually done some public.
Right.
Some public shade tree inventories that actually have the same type of species of trees that we have, that's really what I'm looking for.
Right.
You know, I don't want somebody to, you know, tell me they've done 20,000 palm trees.
Right.
You know, done Baja.
Right.
Yeah, different tree, different, totally different scenario.
Then you just want somebody who works in Northeast.
Yes, basically, and so I can say Northeast and Mid-Atlantic states, because they're very similar tree species and similar climate, so that'd be fine. And then I can also add to this, I haven't got to that part yet, but, you know, delivery services has to be within 3 months from the date of execution of the contract.
I guess I just wonder, would that possibly eliminate, I'm just worried that you'll only get one bid back.
Yeah, the shortness of the time is what concerns me too.
The problem with this though is that we are on a timeline for DCR.
Mm-hmm.
That's the problem.
Funded ourselves.
Yeah, so if we don't complete this by basically the end of October.
Oh, really?
Because we actually have a year from the date of the actual, not the award, but I believe the date of the actual application being submitted, which was.
Oh, wow. So that's what they're going to use?
Okay. I just wanted to.
There's questions I have for Julie.
I think it's the award. I'm pretty sure it's the award. Okay. That's what I remember them telling me.
But right, so.
But nevertheless, yeah. I mean, we certainly do want to get it done this fall, and that's why I'm just saying let's move as quickly as we can on this RFP so we can get the ball rolling. We give people enough time to complete the project, and be willing to bid on it, knowing that they have enough time to complete it.
So I'm comfortable with, you know, Rich doing all that work, you know, and putting everything up bid, reviewing it. I don't feel like I need to be involved in the selection process. I would like to help the consultants, but it's been selected, but because of the compressed timeline, I mean, I feel comfortable with us just having a deadline for comments to get back to Rich.
Yeah.
If we get it, we get it. If we don't, we don't. Mm-hmm. And then meet the consultants that we hired, you know, because if we have to review each RFP, then it'll just take forever. So personally, I feel like it would be nice to meet the person you hired, you know.
Anyone have any other thoughts?
No, what I'll do is, like I said, I'll get this done, I'll email it to you, have it by, I hope, tomorrow afternoon.
Okay.
My goal, and you can make the comments you like, and then I will tell you that I would probably like to have it back no later than Monday.
Okay, I'll just say this, just so the whole committee can react to it, because we won't be able to react to each other's comments, which is not ideal. So one of my hopes, obviously I really want this inventory to not only inventory existing trees, but identify planting spots. And I would love, because I know that it wasn't in our grant application, so this is sort of an added-on thing, or more like a more detailed thing. I would love those planting spots to focus on the most urban residential parts of the city, the parts where people will most benefit from having street trees. So downtown, so if they're identifying planting spots, I'd like it to be mostly in the downtown and then sort of tentacled out.
I thought a way of further describing that, or along with that, was that in places, certainly where there are sidewalks, because that's, I think, defined that area, I'm not sure.
I think the easiest way to do it is just stick a point and then create a radius.
A radius?
That's a good idea.
Because they're gonna end up using a GPS map to do all this work. And so the easiest thing you're gonna do is actually stick a point in the ground and do a radius of...
Half a mile from the center of downtown.
So I think if you're gonna do that, then you can have a couple of those, because there should be one in Florence, a radius. And then there should be a certainly one downtown Northampton, right? There was one other, actually, but a couple of radius.
Yeah, Leeds doesn't really have a downtown.
No, but Florence really does. There are a lot of sidewalks up there.
Yep. People living right in town.
You know, we'll be outside. And also, if you do the downtown, I don't know, I'm not sure. I guess we'll reach through North Street and Holly Street.
The other thing, too, is that, I'm sorry to cut you off, I was just thinking that we should probably also include in that tree sites to be located in a public right-of-way and to include setback plantings.
The only advice I have is make sure you look at the grant that we were awarded, because the scope of services that they provide to us has to reflect what we were...
I know, that's why we can't really look too well. We can't go too far.
Yeah, I don't know.
Well, so far what I'm describing and what Rob's describing is not varying too far. Setback planning is a little different, though. I don't know if...
I think we included some of that in the grant. It's not fresh in my mind, but I think we had like different zones we were going to consider. But no matter what, I think if there's room in there for the grant itself to have these kind of things considered, but I feel like the scope that they provide has to be reflective of what we're given money to do. And I think as long as the RFP references the work that we outline in our grant, we should be okay.
I'm pretty comfortable with the overlapping the LIDAR with the thing. In other words, the information we want to get, might having the LIDAR and combining with the survey might help us identify where setback plantings would be most desirable, because we'll see where there aren't setback plantings and where there aren't potential tree belts. So if we do that, I don't know if it can.
I don't remember referencing setback plantings.
No.
I mean,
no.
I did the last read on
it. Just says potential sites for future tree planting.
Yeah.
It's really kind of very vague.
That's broad.
So just for reference, the trees that we're putting out this spring right now, the 60 trees or whatever, it's about 60 trees. At least half of them are setback plantings. They're big trees and so they're essential if we can keep it going.
It is, but I'm also confident in the fact that you're going to find 1,000 sites in the city.
Oh, yeah.
Because if you were to ever, which I have not been able to do, but to capture all the trees that were cut down, let's say since the 1970s, the replacement of those trees has been, it's been like half a tree, it's ridiculous. Some years there was no replacement. So I think if we give them a point and say, in this radius, you know, we would like to have located in these two radiuses, these two circumferences, we'd like to have 1,000 sites that they keep located. And that's it. Just leave it, and then let them identify them for us, and we have that inventory, that part of the inventory, and then we can still continue to do our setback plans. I would agree with Andrew. We didn't mention setback plans, and you have to believe you said it well, so we can't talk about that, I don't think. We have to really be very careful about
public shade trees.
Yeah, what we're putting out there, it's gotta be public shade trees, because we actually, I think the commission voted to kind of keep it that for this round, and then eventually maybe move to do an inventory of other non-public shade trees, which would be
Barb.
freaking me out.
Wait a second, is it 4:30? It's time to go.
You're dreaming.
I worked through.
Sorry.
Sorry.
I'm low mid response. So I'll put all that together. We'll see what that looks like. I'll work with Andy to try to, Andy Keithers from our office, to try to get a point. We'll have to provide them with, you know, a map of what we're talking about for radius.
But I think Rob's point about the, like, using LiDAR, we'll be able to tell, you know?
Yeah, because we'll be able to take LiDAR and actually use it with our GIS information that we get from the vendor. So that can be done in our own office by Andy, and we can have a presentation for everyone to take a look at.
Yeah, it's a very general, like, you know, this neighborhood has incredibly low tree cover, and you'll right away be able to see that you're not going to be able to solve it with public trees, because there won't be any
William Street,
dots.
All that part of Ward 3 being a perfect example.
Right.
But then we could send, we could go out and, you don't have to drive all over the city, you just,
Also, you know where the most barrenness is. I mean, I kind of know. I mean, I walked down North Street, I went down Lincoln Ave and Walnut, and I saw, hey, there aren't trees. But there could be whole pockets of them, and also the relative lack of trees.
Yeah.
You can measure with LiDAR, apparently. Right. We're smart.
Yeah, and those door hangers that we can hang on doors of houses that could take setback trees would be a big
deal. Right, well then, exactly.
Because we can't do anything without permission.
Exactly.
Right, but then you'd know neighborhoods where you would go to the whole street, you knock on every door, and you put a hanger on every door.
Right.
Comments or questions or concerns?
Inventory?
Yes, and for inventory purposes.
Just one more thing is that I do remember James Lowenthal, who is the king of biking, walking, sort of like our bike walk guru, was chair of the subcommittee of Bike Ped for many years, talked about how a half a mile is the golden number. A half a mile from the center of a town is the maximum distance that a typical person is likely to walk as opposed to drive. And so if you're talking about those radiuses, radii from the center of Northampton and Florence, I think half a mile is a good number.
Mm-hmm. All right, I'll have Andy work that up on a GIS map.
You know, I think you can do a half mile of downtown Northampton. You may not end up with enough spaces.
My only point is priority. It's not just limited. That's just
because when you throw in bound by Smith and bound by some other the geography, I think that until you go out North Street and out State Street and a few other streets further out than half a mile, you don't actually get to where there are public shade trees that we can plant.
I think it would be good to actually get it on a map and see what it looks like.
I see your point. Actually, there, like, that's just taking the arbitrary center of downtown, but there are multiple focal points.
Yeah, well, it would be multiples.
Yeah,
but you could move the center of the radius. Like, if Smith was what was impeding, but you don't want to double count that or whatever. Just move your center point over so that
half
it
mile gets
the
you
downtown.
Out to Myrtle Street off of King.
Myrtle?
Mm-hmm.
That's where Andrew lives.
As long as it includes Myrtle.
So just because I've walked all this.
Gets you over to.
Todd, I've walked all this and said, Myrtle Street's the first place where you could actually, there aren't any public places to put trees. In other words, you can go all the way up to Myrtle Street and you will find almost no places where you can just plop a tree down because you're the tree ward. There aren't any.
I could drill a hole in the sidewalk.
Right. Yeah. Or if you could drill holes in sidewalks, which you could. I mean, we could.
You should have a petition. Let's change around. So you get your one way parking on one side.
I think that would be beautiful.
But I mean, all actually.
We go and only have a sidewalk on one side.
That's right.
And then we can have the other side full of trees.
You're going to get a lot of
revolution.
Myrtle Street.
Yeah, because the Pomeroy to the east.
Pomeroy is good. Going way out Pomeroy is good. Going way out State Street is good.
Going to Lyman or Monroe to the south.
Lyman.
It goes to the athletic fields across Paradise Pond.
Yeah.
Right, right.
I'm excited to have my neighbors.
Yeah.
Do you do anything with overlays, like soil type or depth of water table, so that you can pinpoint, you know, better versus less productive spots?
We can, but not at, we haven't incorporated that into this. That, we could do that. We actually, Andy Keither, I don't know if you know Andy, he used to work in the planning department. He's really awesome at his job, and he makes my job a lot.
GIS and DTW.
GIS coordinator. He actually has been incorporating a lot of different layers into our GPS systems, and he's working on it. And that's one of them, not soil profiles, but actually water flows, which are extremely important, given the kind of nature that we're doing with drainage work and stormwater runoff. So there's a lot of stuff that we're drawing off of that. So hopefully by the time we have all this information, we'll have more information than we can actually make layers. So.
That's cool.
Yeah, it is pretty cool, actually.
I think with urban soils, you know, that USDA, like, urban soil category.
Yeah.
Most of the soil we're planting has been disturbed, I would say.
Yeah, totally.
So by that, I just mean that it's often not, like, you can be right next door and have the whole thing different, because people report stuff.
Yeah, I just remember a report in the Gazette back in the 80s where some of the trees they had planted, some of the locusts out in front of some of the stores had died, and someone at the DPW was blaming it on a high water table.
They did.
Really?
And I nearly fell out of my chair.
Wow.
It's like,
where? Yeah.
Okay, maybe one more comment before we move on from this topic to the next agenda item. Anyone else have anything to say about this?
No.
Okay, did we have someone? Oh, just Virginia left.
If anyone has any comments, that you just send me an email.
Okay. All right, so the next is an agenda item that I chose to put on here, which is the topic of natural gas leaks in our community. This is not new, but it's a little bit more on the surface transparent, because so what I understand is fairly recently the governor signed a law that required gas companies in the state of Massachusetts to disclose all of the leaks throughout the state. And a advocacy organization called HEAT, H-E-E-T-M-A, HEAT MA, put all of their sites on a Google map, and now they're available for everyone. So if you go to heatma.com, you can zoom in on Northampton.
Oh, really cool.
And
what
find out
HEAT,
H-E-E-T, it's an acronym, but it sounds like the word heat. And you can find all the leaks that are reported by Columbia Gas.
Heatma.
Heatma.
M-A.
M-A.
Oh,
Heatma.
And so citizens in our community, a couple of them that are real climate activists, noticed that there are 91 leaks that are recorded by Columbia Gas in Northampton. A shocking number in the street. I just used to live on Orchard Street. It was like, Jesus. But I have a feeling that it's not everything, because I've smelled gas outside my door for a decade, and I've reported it 3 times, and it's not a point on that. But anyway, we know that underground natural gas, when it leaks, asphyxiates trees, asphyxiates plants. I mean, I think we've had some unconfirmed but strongly suggestive evidence that natural gas has killed some big trees in our town, especially along North Street. I remember there was a year when all of a sudden all these sugar maples just went into massive decline without any explanation, and that was what was suggested to me at the time. I, again, unconfirmed, but that's what was suggested to me. So I just thought that we want to have this on our radar. And, you know, because it is, there are some citizens that are bringing this up as an issue. I've actually reached out to the CEO of Columbia Gas to demand some explanations. And that the cost to a municipality for their loss of a major public infrastructure is really not being factored into the whole equation at all. I'm not seeing it at all being factored in. That I think that we should have it on our radar, and in some ways explore this more deeply.
I have tried to get it confirmed, bring sample, they can't test for it, because what it does is it takes up the oxygen space in the soil, and so the plants can't get oxygen, and that's how it kills it. It doesn't really take the gas into the plant, so they can't test for it, is what I've been told.
It fills up the soil pores.
They could test the soil.
Could test the soil.
Right where the tree is.
Yeah. We had a bunch of big rhododendrons die over at Williston because of gas leak. Of course, we couldn't prove it.
It's cool.
Do you know, there are these, this machinery, colloquially called sniffers, that detect natural gas, and they're actually a product you can buy. They're not cheap. They're like $500. But I'm wondering if, since gas leaks are so ubiquitous in our city, before we invest in planting trees in any particular area, I'm wondering if it's worthwhile us acquiring this equipment so that we can at least sniff the area before we plant a tree there. I don't know, maybe that's a ridiculous use of resources, but.
I mean, I don't know if you're gonna be planting, usually you mark it out and you see the gas line and you try to stay away from it. So I don't know like what the plume radio or the plume area is. Yeah.
We're planting really near gas line.
Yeah.
All
the time. Yeah. 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 I try to stay like 6 feet away usually.
You should look to see how many Holyoke has. You know, Springfield has 500 leaks.
Yeah, we have 300, but they've been closing those. What they try to do is they're really proactive about getting rid of them, which I can commend the local utility for, is that they get rid of, I think they try to get, they've increased their funding, but they've been trying to get rid of 30 a year, and I think they're trying to double up to 60.
Is this Justin Holyoke, your friend?
Yeah, yeah. So they're actually doing a really good job with that.
How do they get rid of them, and what's the process?
Either they replace the pipe, or they replace the seal, or they do like slip lining, and that's what they do. It's just basically taking that opening and then finding how much of a problem you need to solve, and then digging it up and then putting a new pipe in.
What I know about gas leaks, which is from the construction trade, is that they travel enormous distances.
Oh yeah.
Especially along sewer lines.
Yeah, they can travel along. That's why they're so dangerous, is that you don't know where the gas is going to go. It's just like water. When you dump water into the soil, it can make big horizontal.
That's kind of disconcerting that there's so many. Is there any way that we can help petition this?
What I had to deal with my street, I had two of them on my street, and that's it. And I kept calling. Like Columbia guys, everybody gets copy from the Carmel Farms, and they'd be like, yeah, we're on that. So finally I had to call the fire department. I was like, look, man, like, you have people who smoke in front of this gas station all day long, and you have a gas leak that's like 50 feet away. Like, I don't want to have a gas station and this gas leak explode.
And you were smelling it?
Oh, yeah, totally. And then eventually, once the fire department got involved, they ended up closing it down and getting everything resolved in 6 months.
Maybe. Well, you know, I mean, numbers of these leaks, if you go to the site, you'll see, so the leaks are categorized as like, categories 1, 2, and 3. And the lowest grade ones are the ones that are not near any buildings or can't be contained, where there could be a buildup of gas, where there could be a potential explosion. And some of those have, it's been decades and decades. They just don't take care of them. And, you know, and so these, I think that's probably what's happening in front of my house. What I'm suspecting is that I'm actually smelling it coming from the sewer. And because, you know, one tack they take for when the gas leaks into the sewers is they replace the closed sewer caps with vented ones. That's a strategy that they use because it can no longer build up to a point where it can be explosive. So they're not really addressing the leak, they're just addressing the potential for explosion. So I would just like to explore this more. Jay, do you have any other examples of recent trees you've seen go in decline where you've just suspected that?
I just know I brought samples over trying to get them to prove it. And they said they can't with a tree sample.
Okay.
So two sites I can think of, seriously, two sets of trees have died. So I have no reason. So that would be a place if we wanted to try and figure out.
The gas company actually says that if you see a plant mysteriously die, it could be a sign.
Like death plumes, they say that.
Well, really, we should
What do we do?
Yeah, what they do is they say, do you see like mysterious dead patterns, you know, on your property, and maybe it's a sign of the leaf.
Oh, so we contact them?
Yeah, and then they say, oh, we're right on it.
Okay, well, there are two properties then where these trees have died twice, and that we've replanted one now the third time, so maybe we'll ask them.
Maybe that's what's happening in Florence.
Yeah. Is the main cause old pipes?
Yeah.
It's a big
soil volume.
Yeah, I mean, that stuff was installed, you know, in the 1890s.
Yeah.
You know,
on the canal system.
And apparently, so the other thing that happened is in the 60s and 70s, they switched from cast iron to stainless steel, and they were installing them using cast iron plumbing techniques, you know? And so they weren't, because one of them is more durable than the other, like you can just beat the hell out of one and it'll be fine. So you had plumbers, you know, switching over to like a more brittle product in the 60s and 70s. So you would have at installation something that was being battered, you know, so you would have less durability built into the system from the beginning. So that's why they're seeing more of these and something built after the 60s.
Just like housing in the 70s.
All right, well, I know that this group of citizens, they're based mostly in the Massasoit Street area, are drafting a letter to our tree commission to ask us to consider this topic. So, you know, I'll probably have it in my inbox by the time we meet next, and then we can think about next steps. I would love for us to explore what the cost of acquiring one of these sniffers is.
Are they getting dead?
I think it would be great to have the power to determine ourselves whether there are more gas leaks out there, especially if we're going to be undertaking the planting of 1,000 trees. That just feels like a good use of funds to avoid planting trees where they're going to die.
I'd like to know more information about like the sniffer, like technology is it using, how accurate it is.
Do you want to be the researcher of that?
It's called a sniffer?
You can Google it, and I'm sure there's a
I have a better suggestion. Why don't you invite Columbia Gas to come to a meeting?
Yeah.
That's a great idea. Okay. All right.
So are people having trees die on Massasoit mysteriously, or what's causing them to?
What's causing them is no, but they've definitely got a number of leaks on their street, right. And they're a hub of climate activists on that street.
Is there an example of a mass community since this came out that kind of tackled this aggressively?
No, I think we are definitely paving the way along with Springfield.
No. Well, I think some of it has grown out of the, you know, the pipeline thing, and then the gas company saying we can't hook any new people up. But I think folks were like, wait a second, we're leaking this stuff all over the place.
Right. We're paying for it.
Yeah, correct. Right. So I think it was like a cluster of topics.
I did some research on that with the local utility. Gas and electric, just because I was wondering what the actual loss is, and they were saying it was probably like maybe a day's worth of power that they lose, you know, compared to the overall demand, like less than a day of power.
Like, out of what period? Like in a year?
In a year. So it's
one's 365th.
But if you also, if you multiply that across every community, then it's a lot of gas that's lost. But it's not something where I think if we fixed them all, I don't know if it would all of a sudden address all of our demand or our supply issues. Mm-hmm. But I think it would go a considerable distance because I mean, it would give you like another day or two of power.
Has there ever been an explosion here in North Carolina?
Springfield, last year.
That's because the guy or person perforated the gas line, right?
That's why we have blue light.
Yeah, we actually drilled a hole through a gas line at Smith Vocational School because basically
it's an exercise, or
it was something we wanted to teach the students about the fire and public safety things to do and not to do. No, we actually were installing the lights from the old David Wright football field up there, and Columbia Gas did erroneously marked their main that runs across the field, and National Grid, who was installing the poles, drilled right through it. And so the whole campus had to be evacuated. Luckily, there was no explosion. My personal answer to all of this, to be honest with you, is my favorite tool to use, because I have the power to do so, is I like to tell Columbia Gas that you can't do any more work. I'm not signing any more of your permits until you do this. Mm-hmm. So I have, I, I don't think I can make them fix the gas leaks, but I do hold them hostage in a sense. Sometimes when they don't do road repair after they do construction, they do a tremendous amount of damage. If you go, if anyone has driven down Pine Street, there's five holes in the brand new pavement there. And this is atypical of them. They come in after we pave a street and they start cutting it up. So we kind of have to hold their feet to the fire. And I don't have any issue holding Columbia Gas's feet to the fire, no pun intended. But I think it would be good actually to have a representative come here and, you know, we can actually kind of ask them as many questions as you like about, you know, what are they planning on doing about all this? And how are they going to do it? And what is the timeframe? And, you know, this, because the city or the Department of Public Works is the charged with issuing trench permits under Massachusetts general law, we are the authority that actually governs what holes are dug in the city that are considered a trench. Columbia Gas, the only thing that is not really considered a trench is when they actually go to do some work up against the foundation of your house and they dig a little hole outside of your house to actually, they put in test meters so they can actually, have a connection between your meter, your feed pipe and the main, so they can actually see if things leaking or not. So, no, it's fine. But everything else they have to do is all has to be done by trench permits. And each trench permit costs $250.
Yeah. Hmm. So is there a way to, like, maybe they, to waive the permit fee for doing these gas replacements?
I wouldn't waive the permit fee.
Because I know, like, in Cambridge, like, the trench permits were, like, it was, like, $2,000. No.
That was
part of the reason why they weren't doing the work. Because they were like, oh, we can't afford
it. You know what doesn't make any sense to me? It's their system. It leaks. Why not? Yeah. It'd be like if the water system leaked. By the time you get to the end of Ryan Road,
they don't make any money on the deal. There's only two entities other than you that right. They're going to listen to. One's DPU.
Yep.
And the other's the Attorney General.
Yep.
Yeah. Yep. The third one is you.
Right. We're the local permitting authority. So.
Okay.
So it's a good conversation. I will tell you that the tree on the corner of Main and Pleasant, there's a tree wall there. That tree has died. Every tree we planted in the last, and there was a gas leak there. Mm-hmm. So that has to be, that tree's dead. It was a red maple, poor choice, but that's all we had at the time.
In front of Florence Main?
Yeah. And we have to take it out, get rid of it. So that's one example of one experience that I've had.
That's right in front of Florence Bank?
Yes. Okay. Yep. Right by the traffic control box there. Mm.
I'll do a little research. I think we need to have a little information on, unless Jay, you know this already, I don't know, just, facts of research on effects of natural gas on trees. Like, what's the concentration, somebody must have done some research.
Frequency in an urban area.
Yeah, I'll try to see what I can.
And I'm actually glad.
Scholarly, kind of, you know what I mean?
I'm actually glad we're bringing this up because every year we've had a pre-construction meeting with Columbia Gas.
Yeah.
And this year we sat at a table this size in our boardroom and met with a lot of representatives. And there was one small piece about how many gas leaks. And they claim that they have 91 active gas leaks. The website here claims that we have 161 active gas leaks. So I'd like to know what the difference is and where they're getting their data versus where these folks are getting their data from.
These folks said they're getting their data directly from the gas company.
So then the person at the table may have been misinformed and there's more gas leaks than we thought.
Mm-hmm. We checked out my Kerbal and Farms because I know that there was one that was just
the category, maybe they only said they consider, the rating system. Maybe he was only reporting the rating system.
So it was an interesting meeting. It was brought up,
does the issue of public infrastructure in the way of trees ever come up as a innocent collateral in their?
Well, what I've been trying to do is that I am implementing slowly into the trench permit process the fact that the NC 300 Section 5 standards have to be followed by every contractor. So it says it in black and white right on the trench permit, and I have taken pieces out of it, and then I try to get out there and inspect every trench permit that comes out, and there's hundreds of them a year, to see if what they're doing is impacting trees. And then the engineering department is on board as well when they're doing their own construction projects that are either ones they're overseeing or ones that we have commissioned ourselves. Go ahead.
If you want to get, you know, aggressive about it, you could ask DPU to open a case on all the, you know, the value, the public value of the shade trees that have been killed or damaged by gas leaks in the Commonwealth, and how that should be assessed back to the gas company.
DPU, Department of Public Utilities, and that's a state entity?
Since you have control over the trench permits, can you put any conditions on the permits that have to do with the soil test?
At this point, I would say, I don't know the answer to that question. There is a possibility a tree could do anything, but the MGL laws are very clear as to what, you know, there, we have to follow MGL laws in regards to trench permits, and what our latitude is in making our own home rules is something that's foreign to me at this point. I can implement the issues about trees that exist because of the nature of the tree warden, and MGL chapter 87 says that I have the power to protect all the public shade trees. That's where I'm getting my authority from. As far as the trench permit, because we are the permitting authority, we have the power. So I have the power to go to a job and shut it off, shut them down, tell them to stop. You're not following anything. Where's your trench permit? First thing, where's your trench permit? Well, it's at the office. Well, you stop, go back and get it, because the law says you got to have a trench permit right on there. You're not following proper trench safety. There's no trench box. So I have all the power to do that, but there's also a certain level that I can't supersede, and the Department of Public Safety has to come in and relate it to those kind of matters when it comes to trenching. So it's kind of a funny line, but it does give me, so every time there's a violation or a neighbor calls and says, hey, my neighbor's digging a big hole in my backyard, and I don't know what they're looking for doing, I have to go and inspect it and say, where's your trench permit? Well, this is private property. I said, it doesn't matter. It applies to all property. Mm-hmm. And where the permitting authority, you have to have a trench permit. It can be real, people really can get really ticked off, actually. It's a different story than what we're really talking about, but it's the whole process of trench permits. It's really a big, I don't know, how many trench permits do you think we issue in a year? I think alone, my guess is alone from Columbia Gas, I think we took in about $50,000 for trench permits alone from them.
You're just checking, when a person plants a tree in their backyard, they don't normally have a trench permit.
Or no, they don't, because it's not, it's got to be, there's a specific lingo for how what a trench is, and a tree is not.
Okay.
Unless you're digging a tree that's
huge.
Yeah.
Right. Okay.
The reason it's big, 3x3 by so many feet long.
I see.
Okay. The reason I do it for the public right of way is because of so many utilities.
Of course. No, I know we need to do it.
Yeah.
But I am tomorrow going to put a tree in someone's backyard.
No, I'm not going to want you to run it.
Or nor do I want to pay 200.
There's a man in a hood with a shovel and a hole.
Okay, I'm going to move us on to other business.
Just one final thought on this. Mm-hmm. What we could do is have the GIS department make a map of all those points, and then overlay it with street trees that you know have died.
Mm-hmm. You could also ask Columbia Gas to produce a GIS layer.
Yeah.
See, Columbia Gas is very funny about how they will. So when they send us maps, and I know we're going to, when they send us maps, they send us these maps that are completely, in my opinion, totally useless. Mm-hmm. And that Jay and I experienced that when they did the, they want to do the test pits by the Elm, by College Lane. It looked like they were working out in the road. Well, they were working right next to the tree, actually, mm-hmm. did these test pits. But they will only give you small snippets of their utility, and that's really for homeland security mm-hmm. reasons. So they kind of hide behind that, which is probably a good thing. So you can't really, I don't know if they would give us a map of all the leaks, because then that would actually, they would probably have to show us the whole utility.
Andy's probably, if he's savvy at GIS, I'm sure he is. There's a program that's stored in a KML layer, and there's a script that goes convert KML to shapefile.
Yeah.
So you can download as a KML and then make it a shapefile, and he could probably make that layer in like 35 seconds.
He could. He did that with the other treatment.
Cool.
So it's all been moved out of there. It's all in GIS.
Okay, great.
So right. I'll talk to him about it.
It'd be interesting to kind of figure out there's a correlation based upon geography.
And so, Chris, maybe if I see places where trees are being repeatedly just dying mysteriously, I'll just give you the address.
It's fine.
I can look up.
You can look it up now.
Right. So I'll look it up.
Okay.
I'll send it to you.
Great. All right. So other business. I've got a couple of things that I wanted to just...
I've forgotten your name where I didn't get you.
Susan?
Are you potentially interested in volunteering to...
Yes.
Okay, so it kind of brings up the issue, because Lily, I think, mentioned that we might want to have a form, like an intake form, like what are you interested in, what have you done before, whatever.
Skill set.
And so the issue that commission, nothing individual to yourself today, would have to go over again, we've been over it once, is who are people volunteering to? In other words, they're volunteering to the DTAW, which is what I do. Now, my volunteer effort, which is completely devoted to the DPW and not to the tree commission. And does the tree commission want to have volunteers volunteering to the tree commission? It's kind of two different things. And so we would have to make that distinction. We could work on both. We could work on intake forms for both. But I thought we'd throw it out there that it's
definitely
two different things.
I actually think that we can simplify that and just have it all be volunteering to the tree warden. And let the tree warden determine whether or not those are things that should be shunted to the commission, or they should be shunted, they should just stay under his directive.
Right. Well, I say the TV tell you, I mean, you can do
yeah.
Tree warden. Yeah, I mean, I'm that's fine with me.
But I just thought that if we're going to start getting more and more volunteers, which I just feel like we are, you know, we're just getting more about out in the media and so forth, it might simplify things if you have a form, or if you, you know, a main database where people have identified what their skill sets are, when their availability is, what their interests are. Kind of like a continuation of what we did with the survey. It would just be a shame to lose that. We already have that, and then to get it in a, you know, get a lot of random ways for all future volunteers coming in.
It would be good to have a database, and then we could actually create a listserv of some sort, or however, a mass mailing, so we can actually communicate with these the volunteers that will be able to do A, and these volunteers will be able to do B, and these volunteers are going to do C, and then actually point them in the right direction, because it's great, it's wonderful to have volunteers. You have to manage them, though. Yeah. And the other thing is that if you don't give them something to do, they're going to stop being volunteers.
Right.
And that's really the whole point of volunteering for this stuff. That, you know, you're not going to pay for it. It's the reward. It's the community service. It's meeting other folks that share similar experiences and goals. And we have to try to find a way to continually. We have to find a way to foster that, you know, and hold on to that, and then be able to tap these people when we need them. Because we're not going to need volunteers for them in the middle of summer. We will for watering, but not for tree planting. This time around, we're not going to need them for doing tree inventory work. We're having a professional person do it. But possibly in the future, if we decide to be able to add to our tree inventory, we can do small inventories on our own. We can take one park, right? You could have volunteers dedicated to adopt a park to do tree inventory based upon the criteria that the vendor we pick puts together in a GIS form for us.
I'm curious, Rich, just because just with the Arbor Day events, you know, with any kind of volunteer solicitation or involvement, I mean, there's a tremendous amount of background email outreach and follow-up and responsiveness. So I know you've got so much on your plate. What do you anticipate for who can manage that?
Volunteers.
I think I would actually probably have a core group of people that, for example, Rob, in a sense, has really kind of taken over, or taken the, I've asked Rob to help me cite places to put all these trees that we have. And Rob is really kind of, he's a member of the commission, but he works very closely with myself and Tony to make that happen. Jay, for example, any kind of questions come up for me that regards to any kind of trees that are in trouble, big trees we have to move. I mean, a lot of Jay is loaded with tremendous knowledge of technical stuff. Jen has been awesome, and this is to my own experience, just with all of you. Jen has been awesome for me in reviewing technical documents and looking at plantings and plant species, you know, like Pleasant Street. So I think that there's different, almost like small subcommittees or individuals who actually can manage certain parts, if they're willing, of these volunteers, you know, as to what they're going to do, how we get there. Well, first of all, we have to figure out how many volunteers we have, what their skill set is, and then we have to try to figure out how we're going to utilize all of them, given all the different kind of small missions we have. And I'm not saying that I'm a professional volunteer organizer. I've worked with a lot of different volunteers for different things. Baseball fields and athletic field reconstruction. I did that for many years with volunteer parents and volunteer kids. And those folks came with, you know, some had some great skill sets because they worked in the field. Some had couldn't use a rake or a shovel. You know, so we had to find something for them to do. And it was not as organized as I feel this is going to be. But it's, you don't want to lose them, I think. So we've got to find a way to get them. They've already bought into this, and we have to find a way to keep them bought in.
I think there's a little bit too much worry about losing the volunteers. I have worked with volunteers where, you know, I circle back after a year of not having any work for them, and they can either plug in or they can't. Yeah, so I wouldn't worry too much about that. Like, we don't want to just have the, you know, horse follow the cart by dreaming up things that we really don't need our volunteers to do. I think that people are going to keep on loving trees, and when they can plug in, they will.
Well, so what's happened is that we had initially in the fall a lot of volunteers that came. Those volunteers, were they really thinking of like coming for a day or two and digging? I want to say that Arbor Day was very successful. It was kind of a culmination of things where suddenly there are volunteers coming to me who want to actually help organize, which is quite different than, and to have sort of a longer term commitment, quite different than what's happened before. And I think that Jen and Marilyn and I have all been involved in trying to actually communicate directly with groups of volunteers. It's a lot of work, and maybe none of us are really that great at it.
So, well, it's the database management piece. Like, I can talk to people, I can, you know, schmooze them up and get them to help, but like, the database management is not my skill set.
There's a whole level of people out there that have now started to come to me who kind of see that we're building something and want to like engage all these different sort of technical and personal skills to kind of pull some of this together. And I'm really encouraged by it. I mean, maybe it won't happen, but it's a real change. I reached out to everybody on that, not everybody, but everybody who said that they were willing to help in that way from the database list that Marilyn helped put together. I got very little to no response. I got one person. So I'm just saying it's a hard and long thing to do, but once we get these people, I do think that the two that I've spoken to that seem to have this higher level of organizing ability than I have, or some other people, they are looking at this, I think, as like their volunteer piece.
Great.
And so
that's perfect.
So it's not a matter of circling back to them, it's a matter of them coming on board, and that's what they spend their Saturday morning doing or whatever. I mean, it's true of me as a volunteer. If there aren't, like, it looked like we weren't gonna have trees for 2007 for not a year or something, I wouldn't have had that much to do, and it's a big piece of what I do. I probably would have wandered off and found something to do. I mean, it's not a threat. Don't get trees and I'll disappear. But it's like, I mean,
the mic's coming, Rob. Honest. I get your point, though.
Yeah, there are. So I'm saying I agree with Rich. I mean, there are other things to do. I might have just gone and like refinished the paint in my house.
I think it would be good to just have a database.
Yeah.
A volunteer. I think we need to start with that because we need to figure out who we have. And then I think I agree with Lily. I hear what she's saying about, you know, some people can volunteer what they can based upon what they're doing. So the same volunteers we had last fall, we may not have this fall, but next fall, oh, my kids are off to college or I'm not going here, so I can volunteer this time.
But again, keeping it going, a big part was the Key Club at the high school.
Yeah.
If they, keeping them online, take some maintenance, and you can't just expect people to show up again if you don't like maintain the relationship.
How about this? I have a spreadsheet of all the volunteers, not only who participated with Arbor Day, but those who from the survey said that they would be interested. I mean, I can just upload that onto a Google spreadsheet that we all have access to, and then you could add yours to that. So for the time being, we have a working spreadsheet that's accessible to all of us?
I think that's a good start. And I actually am a good database person. That's a skill set that I have finely tuned over time. So I'm happy to broaden that. I do think that we should have columns with different categories, like skill set, interests, time available, you know, that sort of thing. It's just so we can sort and identify for any given thing. I also just want to say, none of us should be disappointed if we only get 15% of all who surveyed and said they'd be interested in volunteering, actually volunteering. Mm-hmm. It's very easy for a person when they're filling out a survey to push a button saying, I want to volunteer. Mm-hmm. It's a whole different thing to actually follow through. And from my years of volunteer coordination, that's just reality. Like, accept that really, really low percentage.
And on top of that, when you have that database, if you think you can, and you have confirmed this, if you think you can send out an email saying it doesn't work, if you actually have to have a network
personal contact.
Yeah. And that's why, though I've been doing some of it, Jen's done some, Marilyn's done some in particular, we have to have people for whom that is the core.
We can also have a column on the spreadsheet of contact made. You know, whether it's an email about Arbor Day or in person.
But we need a group of people that for whom that's the core, is trying to keep this thing going in terms of volunteers and making best use of them.
So
once that spreadsheet is uploaded, we can all have access to it. Yeah. So when things come up, we can look at it and sort it according to.
I don't know. Then you can actually maybe find some volunteers that don't have the ability to log trees and plant trees. Right. Some volunteers are actually willing to actually manage and work everywhere.
Great.
Thank you very much.
I'm too old to log trees. I'd rather do that.
We should try these people.
Well, that's exactly right.
And that person could actually be reaching out for 10 people. And then another person can take another 10 people.
Yeah.
And then those individuals can report back to either one or two commissioners, or report back to myself or whomever, and say, this is what we have for the volunteer lineup. This is who we have. Mm-hmm. These people are committed. I mean, like I said, I don't know a lot about this because I have not, volunteer work I've done has been informal. I have a zillion things on my plate, and it would be much easier if someone else were to manage this.
Yeah, that'd be great.
It works well. Like Rob says, we're gonna plant these trees in this place. I'm like, okay, I go look at them and they're fine.
Okay, I'm gonna take two more comments and then we're gonna have to move on to our wrap up of to-dos.
Yeah.
I know what you're thinking.
What? Well, I don't think volunteer coordination is a good use of our time. And I'm hopeful that this will turn into that we can spin this creativity and energy into a separate entity whose core purpose is to coordinate volunteerism around this specific topic.
I think that's right. I mean, I think that's what I've been sort of trying to say, is that I don't think this group is going to run this. That we have to actually find a group of people who will volunteer to take this over.
But it could be some of the people around this table.
Yeah,
underneath the tree warden. Really different jobs, right? I mean, we're a commission. We're an advisory commission. We're working on things like advising on the tree warden inventory, the broader plan of where we're going. But if any of us individually also want to take part in volunteer coordination or in actual on-the-ground volunteering, I think that's okay. Maybe we want to not spend much time during our tree commission meetings, though, talking about it. Maybe that's got to be something that we've got to take on the road somewhere else. I do see your point, and you've brought this up before, and it's a good reminder.
And also, you know, we've had this before us, and I don't think we really picked it up anyway. So, general, the whole volunteer thing. We haven't picked it up yet. It just seems like an unreasonable burden, and it doesn't seem like this group is really wanting to do it, or it doesn't seem like it seems like it's good to have someone else do it.
Well, what end of the rope do you want to start at? Do you want to start with what you need, or with what people are interested in?
Well, I think each person will, we won't do that here too
long.
I think that I have found some people who want to start a little core of people who are figuring this out, and that I've been working with other people, and
right now, I think just by default, I'm the person who, between Rich and the group, and I'm willing to get out of that role, but I can't right now, because I think if I did, it wouldn't work. So, fine? Yeah, go ahead.
What we have is, through various methods, a survey and Rob's relationships before the tree commission, et cetera, a pile of names of people and contact information. So sometimes we have information of what they're willing and interested to do. So that's what we got. So I think, to me, the picture I have is if somebody could, you know, organize that. And then let's say we've got 40 trees to plant in April. We could come to that person or persons and say, we've got 40 trees to plant. Rob and I are kind of spearheading that. We need volunteers. Well, how can we, and then either other people call them, or, you know, I say I can call five, or, you know, whatever. That's my vision.
So it's
to, you know, have a
last comment, and then we've got to wrap up.
And we've been actually doing that some, right. But we've been doing it kind of like a little, you know, and but there's more than just planting the trees. There's right. There's our public face. We have these other projects that we're interested in, like labeling trees, putting signs up. There's a whole
watering, all kinds of
water, stuff. There's a whole, but it's not just physical. There's a whole. I mean, the people I'm talking to all say there should be some social media element to the whole.
So that brings up a good point. If you have a social media element.
Goes through the mayor.
It goes through the mayor, but I think actually having a volunteer group is separate. It doesn't have to. So that volunteer group can approach the tree warden and say, I have these volunteers to work. We are raring to go. As long as the thing is that any kind of press release that comes from this appointed body by the mayor or myself has to go through the mayor. Right. But if we have
just an ad hoc citizen.
Yeah, right. Yep, right. It would actually work really well.
Facebook set and people can see what's happening, like what we're doing.
Yeah, it's kind of it's
we're far from that. We're very far from that, but it would be fantastic.
Okay, there's lots of other business that I would have liked to have gotten to, but we didn't. We'll save it for next week. Nothing burning urgency. So I'm just going to turn to Marilyn and ask her to sum up some of the tasks.
One thing quickly, I forgot to mention our Tree City USA award, mm-hmm. where it's going to be given in Worcester.
Oh, yeah.
So I had the ability to take two other folks. We're only allowed three this year because of space constraints.
Anybody does the mayor want to go?
No, I already asked him. He's already got other commitments.
Can you tell us what date it is?
I believe it is June 15th, and I will drive.
And I'm going to go to the Armsby Abbey.
Tree Campus USA.
I'll go to the Armsby Abbey.
You're
going to
be
lunch.
There with. You're
going to
be there
anyway?
Yeah.
Yeah. It's the College of Holy Cross.
Right?
Is it 15?
Yeah, it is on the 15th.
Yeah, so we have to be back in Northampton for a public shade tree commission anyway. So, and the mayor is probably going to end up having us do some kind of a photo op during that meeting with our award. And he's going to tweet it, of course. He's got to love that phone, baby. Mr. Phone. We should call him Mr. Phone.
I enjoyed going last year.
So I don't need to know today if any of you can go. I think I have until like next week to get the information.
Okay, so. Great. All right, Marilyn.
Sorry, Marilyn.
Oh, no, that's good. Thanks. All right, as I mentioned at the beginning of the meeting, Lily and I were talking about the Google Doc where we keep track of the to-dos, and we thought just because the list is getting longer and longer, it would be easier to visualize and manage if each commissioner had a tab. So I did that this morning. So there's now a tab for each commissioner with simply the date of the meeting and I created a topic column. So like for instance, Arbor Day or tree inventory and then the to-do. So, and I think it would be best if people sort of self-manage it. So, you know, just check it between meetings and before the meeting, just update it. Either the item has been done or the comments on the progress. Okay, so running down the list here, Rich, under Arbor Day, follow up at Sale, the principal at Leeds regarding the tree planting tomorrow. Plant the remaining tree whips in the cemetery, there are 20 left over. Tree inventory, request a contract extension, which ends on June 30th.
Yep.
Complete the RFP and then send to the commissioners to review. Ask Andy to create a GIS layer, including tree death sites with gas leak sites, which Andrew suggested. And a carryover item was just to follow up or ask Dave, the engineer, about the oak tree behind Academy Music. We had talked last meeting about concerns about construction compaction and perhaps air speeding as an option to help revive it. Lily, you're going to follow up about the door hangers, two additional door hangers with a designer to see if you could take that on. Setback planting and volcano mulching. Lily and Jen, we're going to begin an op-ed piece about solar panels versus shade trees.
We have like, give me another week and a half.
Yeah.
You would say like mid-May.
Yeah, mid-May's too ambitious.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah, I can't do it yet. Yeah.
All right.
I need a couple more weeks.
And Lily, invite the Columbia Gas to a tree commission meeting. Todd, inquire about burying utilities off of the Main Street reconstruction. Jen, investigate the gas leak sniffer. Marilyn, I'm gonna update the Google spreadsheet with this to-do list, as well as from now on I'll send Terry the to-do list to add to the meeting notes. Arbor Day, the last thing I need to do is compile photos, and I'll send that to the commissioners. And Lily and Jay, I know you have some photos. If you want to send those to me, I can include them. I'm also gonna draft a proposal for the Memorial Tree Program by mid-May. And I will upload the spreadsheet onto Drive to start this volunteer database and include columns for skill set, interest, time available. And Susan, before you leave, let me get your info and I'll add you to that. Rob, gonna complete the tree planting tomorrow, I believe.
That's right.
And I'll be helping you with that. And then the one carryover item for you was the draft language for setback planting for the door hanger.
That's me. Yeah.
Yep. Did I miss anything?
Yeah. These three
species OEs. List.
A tree
species.
List.
Yeah.
Oh, species. Okay.
Species tree list.
Oh, Forbes Library.
Oh, you have something to. Yeah. Something on Forbes?
Well, we have. We told them we would help them work up a list of tree replacements.
Oh, who's going to be doing that?
It was
the tree
Lily, Jay, and S.
Lily, Jay, and Rich. Okay.
Yeah.
We can talk about it later.
Okay. Yeah. Is there anything else anybody wants to do to add to this?
No, that's great. Thanks. That's very comprehensive. Well done.
Nice job. Well, you've been typing the whole time.
Man.
Yeah. Everybody has their quirks. I like kind of keeping track of what needs to be done. So
good.
I don't mean to like get on anybody's case.
Really, right?
That's a good, that's a good skill
set. Thank you, Meryl.
All right, it's 6:03, so I'd like a motion to adjourn this meeting. Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Meeting's adjourned.